explosion in news because of the advent of smartphones and super fast internet connections. So people want to know a lot of news, especially pertaining to their industry. And the industries are rapidly changing. So there is a need for people to get the kind of news that they want. It could be local news or industry related news. And because of fast internet connections, we are able to get that. So naturally, there is a demand for more news, more media houses, and therefore more journalism jobs. You need a professional degree to be a doctor, a lawyer, an engineer. I would think that journalism is also a profession which calls for specific kind of skills, some specific traits, and a specific kind of attitude. Although in the past, maybe 20-25 years ago, there were no journalism schools to cater to. Today, news, media is a very, very specialized profession. I wouldn't think anybody with, people often have this myth that they have good language, they have good English, whatever language skill, and they can become a journalist. I'm sorry to say that just having good language, it is one of the traits, but you will have to have other traits which can be honed only in a professional course. So I would say that one of the first prerequisites of becoming a journalist and pursuing a career in the media is a professional degree. So you can opt for a BCJ, which would be like a bachelor's in communication in journalism, or if you are not sure and you already done a graduation in science or maths or arts and you would like to pursue journalism, you can go for MCJ, which is Master of Communication and Journalism. And there are very specified courses only for journalism, like MCJ and BCJ have again things like corporate communications or advertising. Or you could go specifically for journalism schools like Asian College of Journalism, Symbiosis, JNU, and a couple of other universities. And there are many private colleges which have specified 1 year or 9 month courses. And these courses are very, very specialized. They actually put the students across on practical and theoretical knowledge so that by the end of 1 year, they are like plug and play for media houses. Teens of today are so much more, fortunately, I guess they don't have this pressure that I have to work, I need a job, kind of a thing. I mean, now I'm 40 plus, but when I joined journalism, for me, a job was extremely important. It was almost like a life and death question. I was under the impression that even if getting a 3 month break between jobs would mean that, oh my God, I'll have to depend on my parents, and that's not something I want to do. So for me, a job was extremely important, and my value system towards my job was different. I would go to any extent. I mean, even if I was not well, I would be like, no, I don't think I can put up leave. Let me work today, kind of a thing. But perhaps maybe because of their parents are placed better, or they have many more resources, they can afford to probably stay chill and take a break. I find that they are not like do and die kind of a thing when it comes to work. If things work, they are in a mood, they do. I feel they can afford to be a little more professional be more dedicated to deadlines, be more dedicated to their work, deliverables and things like that. But again, I think some of these traits come because of where you come from, what kind of background you come from. But still, I think once you decide to come into journalism, for example, right now, during the lockdown, I think only 10% of services are working. And I am one of the 10% who goes to work even during the lockdown, even during the curfew. I still have to go to office, make sure that my pages are in place. So it calls for extra discipline. You will have to, as a media person, always put your profession perhaps ahead of your personal reasons. I mean, things always go wrong, but you'll have to work out other ways. So unless it's like a huge, really big health emergency or something, I think 80 or 90% of the time, you will have to put your profession ahead of your personal needs. Now, that calls for passion, that calls for commitment, that calls for this, you should be married to this whole genre of storytelling. If you have that in you, please choose media. If you're somebody who's chilled out, who don't believe in journalism, and you think I will write when I feel like it, I'm sorry, you should just be writing a blog and not really get into professional media. The power of persuasion begins with first convincing yourself that the story that you're putting out is going to make some impact, or it's going to be useful for the people you are writing for. And of course, there is also something called selling of the idea, because when you suggest an idea, typically it has to be approved by your editor, who in turn will give you the go-ahead to pursue the story and the space in the website or in the newspaper or wherever, or in the TV channel that you're working for. So you will have to have a lot of background information on why you think you are pursuing the story and why you think that story should be out there. Who is it going to impact? How is it going to help anybody? What is the number of people that will be affected by your story? These days, newsprint is very expensive. Time slots in television is expensive. So what is it that makes your story be there? So naturally, you will have to have the power of persuasion, because you may have done a lot of hard work to work on a story. But if you cannot get the right slot or the right space in the media, wherever you're working, it doesn't make sense. So it's a package. You'll have to have a great idea. It has to be impactful. It has to touch many lives. And your editor has to be convinced. So you'll have to go through the whole thing to make sure that what you write is there at the right place. Definitely. Like you mentioned, deadline means a deadline. I mean, you will be dead if you don't meet. In fact, it has become much more important in these days of breaking news. Unfortunately or fortunately, one has to maintain timelines, and you will have to get the best out of what you are doing in that specified timeline. For example, I work for a national newspaper, and every day we have a certain kind of deadline. Let's say my team has to give their stories by 6 p.m. or maximum 7 p.m. So there is no point that you work till 11 o'clock and then you are not able to put the story for the next day's newspaper. Timeliness is extremely important. So one has to give a great story with all the quotes, all the background, everything authenticated, yet in the timeline that is specified. So if you're talking about teenagers, yes, that's a trait one has to sort of get into their psyche and their system, just as you need to submit, you are writing an exam and there is a timeline, you'll probably get 2.5 hours to write. It doesn't matter how much you know, but in those 2.5 hours, you will have to perform to your best of ability to write and reproduce the answers. So similar way, teenagers will have to have a certain discipline towards timelines. Respect that, only then they will be able to survive. And this is a high pressure environment. There are times you will have to give up on your lunch, dinner, or even talking to your family. You'll have to say, listen, stop, I have a story. I need to tweet it right now. I need to put up a post. I need to write the story. I need to send a scroll. So timelines are very important. And unfortunately, if you are in a media house, putting out the news comes ahead of everything else. So that kind of a commitment is very, very essential. One has to read. You'll have to read more than what you write, so that you have more inputs into your brain. Read very good authors, read very good writers. I mean, both in terms of books and in terms of news and editorials, so that you know the kind of usage that you need to do to put across a forceful sentence, the convincing sentence. How to build it, how to write an interesting point and a very impactful point using the right kind of words. So you will have to keep reading constantly, all kinds of readings. I would say not just, editorials, but I would say even be on social media, understand how people are doing campaigns. What is the language that people are talking? Is it casual? Is it chatty? Is it racy? Is it professional? Is it serious? Understand what the public is doing and incorporate that, if possible, into the kind of writing. For instance, I might write a serious story for my newspaper, But I might put a different kind of post when I'm putting it up on social media. So all these skills, who are you writing to? Who is the person who's going to probably click on your story? You need to understand your audience and write accordingly. In fact, I had attended a couple of sessions about fake news recently, I mean, before the lockdown and all started. In fact, social media companies like Twitter, like Facebook, YouTube, and WhatsApp, all these media are also trying hard to ensure that fake news doesn't get circulated. You know, because like they say, WhatsApp University, where everybody thinks a sort of believes any sort of fake news that is put out, especially during lockdown. We're talking about the isolation. We're talking about symptoms. There are so many things that need to be authenticated. So social media websites themselves are now taking efforts to make sure that fake news doesn't go. For example, if you've seen previously, you could press one button and you could send across you could share the story across all the people in your WhatsApp group. Now it is not so. I think it's only 5 or maybe 3 at a time. So you can't send your story more than 3, so that in case it is fake news, it doesn't spread so much. So I would think that there is a time where these kind of social media sites will actually tie up with the local media houses, perhaps across countries or continents, to make sure that authenticated news only is put up. And I must tell you that Rice Bucket Challenge is also a social media initiative, as in it runs through social media. So I'm very thankful for this media, which is there with informal media. So my initiative is an example of how you can convert an adversity into an opportunity. Right now in the lockdown, there is nothing that's happening, and people across the country, you know, how many people have lost their job, they're not able to work. So at that kind of a time, an initiative like us is trying to feed people. We've just crossed 25,000 kgs of supplies a couple of days, in fact today. So if you talk about positive change, I think it's an example of how you can be at home and using your network, using small tools like the phone and the network, and using your connections, you can actually bring about a social change. What I am doing here is using all these tools I just told you. I have a smartphone, I have a Wi-Fi, I have about 15,000-20,000 people following me. I use all these tools to make sure that there is some kind of an offline, offline engagement with people. I mean, we are actually feeding people with food that will sustain them until the lockdown. So this is an example of how you can use online for offline impact. It's very important for us to keep our children grounded. Like, I have a single child. I mean, I have a daughter at home. She's 14. She doesn't have siblings. And but for me, it's very important to put this into her brain that, she cannot feel entitled to things. She can enjoy things. She can relish things. She can ask and even demand, but she cannot feel entitled, which means she cannot feel that, oh, because I'm a single child, I think you should give me. Because you don't have any other children, I should be getting maybe a lot more than what the next child should get. So it is the duty of the parents to tell them and teach why it is important to be caring and sharing and show some sensitivity towards your fellow human beings. And for example, now my own Rice Bucket Challenge, I do it because I want to do it. I do not earn any money out of it, neither now nor have I earned, nor will I be doing it in the future. But I'm doing it because I feel the need to care for my fellow human beings. I feel the need to share what I have. So my own initiative is a great example of how you can care and how you can share with what you have. You don't have to be like a Sudha Murthy or a Nita Ambani to do philanthropy and charity, but with what you have, where you are, you can be a person, you can be a caring and sharing person. And it is for the parents to inculcate this. Don't say too much, show it by your actions. I think when you do something, kids learn it faster than when you tell them. So be an example of whatever you want to teach them, whether it's, you know, values of life or something like caring and sharing.